to Staying the Course. Join us as we navigate the uncompromised Word of God with Pastor Brett Peterson.
I love your word. I love.
So let's welcome him, shall we? So good morning, everyone. Great to be here. And our friend Joe Byrne will interpret for me. He can explain everything I didn't say along the way. But it's really, really great. Thank you, Pastor Brett and Cheryl. It's a great privilege for us to be here. You know, whether you talk about a church, whether there's two in the church or a thousand in the church, it doesn't really matter. The main thing is that Christ is at the center of what we do. And just as we begin, I struggled a bit getting, because I wanted to talk about Ireland and the church, but God gave me a specific word for the church here, and specifically for you that I got it this morning. But we came to know the Lord just in 1991, 27th of September, Friday at 12 noon for me, so I know when I crossed the border. I know when I entered into the kingdom and left the other kingdom behind. And myself and Elizabeth were in a lot of trouble, our marriage was in a lot of trouble, and I was filled with shame, and I was filled with guilt, and no one had ever told me about the love, grace, or mercy of God. I never knew that. And what, you know, people say, did you find Christ? He wasn't lost. I was the one that was lost. I didn't find him. He found me. Right? And he sought me out of what is it, almost 7 billion people. He came and he sought me out in the size of the universe, zoned in to the earth, zoned into Ireland, a small little island with 6.3 million people, of which there's only 1% evangelical in the entire nation, north, south, east, and west. And we've come from a great tradition known as the land of saints and scholars, but no more. And I'm going to finish with something at the very end, that really a story that explains how we got into this condition and how the rest of the world are following suit unless we change course. But usually when an Irishman gets up, he tells a story about Paddy Irishman, Paddy Englishman, and Paddy Scotsman. Would that be fair? But I changed it around a little bit. There was this millionaire, and he wasn't too secure in his salvation. He was dying. He knew he had about a month to live. And he drew together three religious people that he thought he could trust. Because what he wanted to do was, he wanted to bring his money with him, as many people do. And he called together a priest, a pastor, and a rabbi. And he said, guys, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you $10 million in cash each. And when on the day I die, I want you to come and just put it into the casket and don't let anyone know. I know I can trust you because you're three heads of religious orders. And so, behold, the man died, passed away. And just at that evening when the three guys passed and they all slipped something into the casket, but no one knew what it was. But the three guys met up later on and they said to the priest, well, how did you get on? Did you put the 10 million in? Well, he said, all bar 3 million. Because the church roof is falling down, you know, it's dangerous, so I had to make that investment, but I put the rest in. And I look at the pastor and said, surely, hey, we can trust the pastor. What did you? Yeah, well, all about 2 million. Because really, you know, we're doing an outreach, you know, we're doing a soup run, we need it, but I put all the rest in. And then they looked at the rabbi, said, how about you? The rabbi said, every single penny. The day that he gave me the money, I lodged it in the bank and I wrote him a check for the full amount. Yeah, take some moment. So let me begin this morning with another story. It's not about a rabbi, right? One winter night in 1935, one of the most famous mayors of New York, Farrillo LaGuardia, showed up at the night court in one of the poorest areas of the city. He dismissed a judge and the night for the night and took over the bench. That night, a tattered old woman, charged with stealing a loaf of bread, was brought before him. She defended herself by saying, my daughter's husband has deserted her. She is sick and her children are starving. The shopkeeper refused to drop the charges, saying, it's a bad neighborhood, Your Honor, and she's got to be punished to teach other people a lesson. The guardian sighed. He turned to the old woman and said, I've got to punish you. The law makes no exceptions. $10 or 10 days in jail. However, while pronouncing the sentence, LaGuardia reached into his pocket, took out a $10 bill, and threw it into his hat with these famous words. Here's the $10 fine, which I now remit. And furthermore, I'm going to fail to fine everyone in the courtroom 50 cents for living in a city where people have to steal bread so that their grandchildren can't eat. Mr. Bailiff, collect the fines and give them to the defendant. The following day, a New York newspaper reported, $47.50 was turned over to a bewildered old grandmother who'd stolen a loaf of bread to feed her starving grandchildren. Making forced donations were a red-faced shopkeeper, 70 petty criminals, and a New York policeman. My subject is about God's mercy. You see, when I came to know Jesus, I was in desperate need of mercy and justice. And so too all of us here. When I looked up, I just did a little search of California, what was happening. I'm a counselor in the background, engineer first, then became a therapist, a Christian therapist. And in Ireland, we have about 7.7% of the total population that suffer from depression. Suicide is very high among young males between the ages of 20 and 27 years old. But I looked up California. You're 9.9% of the population who suffer from depression, hopelessness, anxiety, suicide, because they're without hope. We live in a world that is without hope. And we are people who understand something of mercy. And yet I believe that's what God has asked me to talk to you about. And I often find mercy and grace, they kind of get mixed up in my head sometimes, right? And something I don't deserve, unmerited favor, we know that is grace. Where mercy is about letting someone off or give me mercy, please don't give me justice. Please do not give me justice. Because justice, you've got to nail me to the cross. So this is what I want. So 2,000 years ago, when Jesus walked on the earth, people seemed to understand what mercy was. In fact, even the beggars seemed to have a good grasp of it. And we read in Luke's Gospel, Luke 18:35 says this, as Jesus approached Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard a crowd going by, he asked what was happening. They told him, Jesus of Nazareth was passing by. He called out, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Those who led the way rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, son of David, have mercy on me. Jesus stopped and ordered a man to be brought to him. When he came near, Jesus asked him, what do you want me to do for you? Lord, I want to see, he replied. Jesus said to him, receive your sight, your faith has healed you. Immediately, he received his sight and followed Jesus, praising God. When all the people saw it, they also praised God. So this blind man didn't need a lot of encouragement to call out. He knew something. He had heard something about Christ as he was going by, and he cried out, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. He knew that Jesus had the power to heal. He knew something more than the ordinary onlookers that were there. He must have heard the stories of all the miracles that he performed. The miracles at the wedding of Cana. I wonder, did he hear about the Samaritan woman who went back and became the best evangelist the Samaritans had, where an entire village was saved? Did he hear about the feeding of the 5,000, the lame who could walk, or the deaf who could hear, the blind who could see, and the dead who were even risen? He heard something because even when the crowd told him to be quiet, hush, be quiet, he cried out again, son of David, have mercy on me. Son of David. Son of David, who would be the Messiah, the Christ man, the man who was fully God, fully man, the Savior of the world, God with flesh on. And when we think about Jesus, that's what we got to recognize. Jesus is fully God. He is God with flesh on. He is the incarnate God who cloaked his majesty, who got the entire universe and somehow cloaked it with flesh upon himself. And he cried out again. He said, son of David, have mercy on me. This is a beggar, a blind man, sitting in the dirt, crying to the Savior of the world. And we see the result. Jesus did heal him. He heard him. Not just his voice, but Jesus recognized something of faith, something of destiny within the voice of this guy. And Jesus said, he said, what do you want? Really interesting question. It was a whole other sermon. Because some people don't need to be healed. They don't want to be healed. And if they were healed, they would not know who they are. We have a deaf guy in our church. He's on our leadership team. Peter Redmond is a deaf. And about 4 years ago, he went back to the doctor because he needed a new hearing aid, because he can pick up vibrations. And the doctor said to him, why don't you put the hearing aid in your good ear? He said, Peter, no, this is my good ear. He said, no, something has shifted. Something has shifted in his hearing. And so he exchanged the hearing ear to this side. And he came out, and Peter was almost driven demented because he started hearing noises and grumblings. And our worship at times, we would have it turned up a little bit, but Peter could never hear it. He started complaining that the noise was too loud. Imagine what it is for a deaf man and for a blind man. Imagine what it is to be changed. Imagine for us, whatever sickness or whatever is going on in our lives, for Jesus to transform us, who would we be? What would it be? And whose would it be? Mm-hmm. And I believe the very question then has to be asked of ourselves this morning. Jesus saying, what do you want to do for me? What do you want for me? Do you want forgiveness, healing, intimacy, provision, reassurance, hope, acceptance? Do you have a physical, spiritual, emotional need? Because the only one who can cure you, the only one who can heal you, is a person whose name is Jesus.
Amen.
I mean, the doctors are still practicing medicine. One day they might get there, but between now and then, they're going to practice on you and practice on me. So to him, what do you want from Christ? What do you want from Jesus? Who is he to you? Is he someone that you just turn up and you worship once a week or once a day? Or is he Lord God of your entire life, destiny, dreams, family, eternity? Is he the one? Is that it? Or is he just something on the side? Is he just something just in case? In Ireland, we used to have it. You know, I come from a traditional. We said, well, just in case. You never know. It's like the insurance policy. Just in case I kick the bucket. But Jesus simply said, receive your sight. Your faith has healed you. So there's something about an element of faith. And we know we don't need a lot of faith. We know it's even a fact. Sometimes we get carried away with this term, faith. We say, you've got great faith. It's not about faith. It's about whose your faith is in. And according to Scripture, all you need is a tiny, 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 tiny bit. The size of a mustard seed. But it's who is that faith in? Because when our faith is in the God of the universe, who created all things, who sustains all things, who holds matter together, you will need a lot of faith for that God. But he did two things. Number one, he followed Christ. He got healed and he followed Christ. And so we know that miracles are a sign. This is a scripture I learned the first couple of months we came to the Lord. John 20:30. So Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. So the miracles in themselves are just signs. Because even when you raise Lazarus, Lazarus died again, I tell you. Yeah? We come along, we wheel some in a chair, God takes him out of the chair, great. But our faith must be in Christ, not in a miracle. Yeah. We don't follow the miracle. We follow the one who created all things. All the time. Everywhere. But the sign, the miracles are the sign. Number two, it says he began to praise God. And recently I did just a whole study on praise and just three little things on praise and the power of praise. Number one, praise releases purpose, praise releases power, and praise releases prisoners.
Yeah.
And I want to tell you, when you're depressed or you're down, you begin to lift your head up and see the God of heaven and earth, your problems begin to diminish. Because you see the God of heaven and earth. And we all know that. We all know that. But occasionally, we've got to lift our head back up and say, God, I'm going to stop looking at my own belly button. I'm going to stop looking internally. I'm going to stop looking at me. I'm always going to start looking at the reflection. I'm going to look at you, the God of heaven and earth. And somehow we realize that God's plan, God's purpose, and God's eternity is a little bit bigger than my problems and my difficulties on earth. I looked up what this word and mercy means in a dictionary. And it says it's about amnesty. It said he threw himself on the mercy of the court. Amnesty, the formal act of liberating someone. Another one, it says, it's a disposition to be kind and forgiving. It's a disposition of our heart. It's a condition. It's an attribute that we can get. The quality of compassion or consideration for other people. Pity, the human quality of understanding the suffering of others, but wanting to do something about it. Not just seeing something on TV is, oh, it's not terrible. That's awful. But actually, yes, looking is terrible. Let me take action. So action always follows when we look at mercy. Mercy is the feeling that motivates compassion, merciful, compassionate, deep awareness of and sympathy for another's suffering. Compassionate feelings that support a willingness to forgive. A willingness to forgive. To realize our mercy. That no matter what people have done to us, no matter how many times you've been stabbed in the back, no matter how many times they keep walking away from you, we keep forgiving, we keep forgiving, we keep forgiving, and mercy wins out. So when you put them together, amnesty, the formal act of liberating someone, kind and forgiving, compassionate, considerate for other people, understanding the suffering of others and wanting to do something about it, compassionate feelings that support a willingness to forgive. This is what grace. Grace is getting what I don't deserve. Mercy is not getting what I do deserve. Can you get up this morning? Mm-hmm. We have received mercy. If you're here this morning and you're a follower of Christ Jesus, you have received mercy. When we look at the cross, we should be nailed to the cross. But he took it. Not just took, but became. And I don't fully grasp that. But my little mind would probably blow. But somehow he became sin. All of it. The worst of that humanity. Everything that we have ever been, are, our thinking, our actions, he became in an instant hanging on the cross. Where can we find such mercy? Is it just a story from 2,000 years ago? Or is this living and active and breathing? Yeah. Is it really?
Yes.
Do we live it out? Do we believe it? Do we trust in it? Is our anchor, our foundation? And we've got to keep coming back. This is real.
Yeah.
This is real. And we can get caught up sometimes in the historical Christ. We can caught up so much in churches and different positions and philosophies and the living, active, breathing with God. We've got to keep coming back and coming back. What does the scripture say about Jesus? Hebrews 4:14 says this. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who is ascended into heaven, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weakness, but we have one who is being tempted in every way, just as we are. Yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we might receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Again, something we have to wrap our heads around, that somehow Jesus has experienced everything but yet was without sin. Mm-hmm. And that does away with this whole thing of condemnation. Conviction is a good thing. Conviction of the Holy Spirit, conviction of Scripture is when you know you do something, it's very specific. AA, back up, stop, go away, correct. But condemnation is that thing that comes from the enemy, that I feel not quite good, or not quite a Christian, or don't read my Bible enough, or don't pray enough, or blah, blah, blah. Bro, that's condemnation. But there is no condemnation. He understands us. He's with us. He strengthens us. And Peterson puts it like this in the Message, and I like the Message. I study RSV and the NIV, but the Message throws me sometimes. It gets me to look at a different angle. It gets me to look and go back and check, is this what it really says? Listen to what the Message says. It says, now that we know what we have, Jesus, this great high priest with ready access to God, let's not let it slip through our fingers. We don't have a priest who's out of touch with our reality. He's been through weaknesses and testing. He's experienced it all. All but sin. So let's walk right up to him and get what he is so ready to give. Take the mercy. Accept it. And regardless of what's happening in your life, but if you're like me, you've lots of stuff going on in your head. Lots of stuff going on in your heart. Lots of stuff going on emotionally, in your family and friends. And there's times when you might think that maybe you're just floating in air. And there's other times you wonder, well, that is, am I really saying it? That's the reality. There's times when you're sitting in worship and you're thinking, is this real? All those thoughts come. And I'm a pastor. I pastor a church. I have those thoughts that come through. It's like the crows flying over your head. The thing is, don't let them nest. Let them keep on flying. But we all have these different thoughts and different emotions, and we keep going. We must take the mercy of God, accept He said, Jesus, you understand what I'm like. You understand what it's like. You understand what I'm going through. Yes, I do love you. Lord, I repent. I turn back. I come back because you're my King. But what the enemy tries to do is to think, no, you're not. You're unworthy. This is what I said to our people back home. Yes, you are unworthy. No, you don't deserve it.
That's right.
You don't deserve it because of His grace, because of His mercy, because of His love. I'm a child of God. I'm a son of God. I am cleansed. I am forgiven. I am not the great I am, but by the grace of God, I am who I am. And that's what we got to get that straight. So this morning, His hand is outreached to us in mercy. He's liberated us and He wants us to continue in His freedom. He understands our suffering. He understands not just what we're doing, but He understands that we need His power to get through it. You know what? One of the great things I had when I became a Christian, I was walking this way, and my marriage was breaking up, and somehow I didn't have the ability. And some people think this is what happens in Christianity, that you come along and Jesus comes and he takes your sin, He does, and He forgives you, and He does, and he took my sin away, He took my shame away, He did all that. But He did more than that. He gave me the ability to turn 180 degrees. He filled me with power. He gave me His word. He filled me with His Holy Spirit. And now I can walk in this direction. So yes, I'm forgiven. Yes, I am forgiven. And His shame is taken away. My guilt is taken away. But I am empowered now to live the good life. And that's where grace and mercy. Grace is when I do sin, and grace is to prevent me from sinning. It's a double-edged sword, and it really has to be a double-edged sword. God has given us, and He has the resources and the willingness to help us live the life as a Christian. Well, it is to be a Christian. And when I talk about a Christian means something special for me. It means that I am empowered by the Holy Spirit, that I have the Word of God within me. That somewhere I became regenerate. I am born again. So 23 years ago for me, what happened was, I was given a blank sheet and started again, but this time with the powers of heaven, the Word of God and the Holy Spirit right with me. I am empowered. And I have not been left on this earth. You know, I have heard a lot of theologians, a lot of people, well, the reason you're left on this is the earth has become more holy. It tells me, as you lower me into the ground, I'm going to be made perfectly holy. Sanctification is a process. I have been, I am being, and one day I will be, but not till one day. So we haven't been left on this earth to become holy. Some people think, well, this is like a practice ground. No, it ain't. Run me down with a truck and my practice is over. I don't need practice. My practice ended at the cross. The only reason that P.J. Booth has been left on the face of this earth is to tell somebody else about the good news of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
The only reason that you exist, folks, is to tell your neighbor, your family, your friends, your colleagues, the people in the store, the people that you walk across, is that Jesus Christ is real. John 3:16 is real. And don't let him wait on their deathbed to find out. Right? But let him. And that's what we're about. So everything we do must be to reach our neighbor. Out of the overflow of mercy. Out of the overflow of the goodness and the kindness of God. That's why I believe we exist. Ephesians 2:3 and 5 says this. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. But because of His great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgression. It is by grace you have been saved. It is pure, pure, pure grace. We have not earned it. We cannot pay it back. It is just by the grace of God. That we stand and that we sit and we say, He is our Lord. And everybody we know should be presented with that message. I have people in our town. We live in a town that's 23,000 people. I don't know what's in this town. I know, but in California, it's about 38 million people. But people come to me and say, Peter, when I get my life straightened out, I'll come to church. And you know why that is? Because somehow they've been told a lie by the church that you've got to have your life straightened out. We have buckets outside our church where people can have a smoke on the way in. See, I'm not into behavioral modification. I'm a cognitive behaviorist. That's my background. I don't believe in behavioral modification. I believe in transformation. Yeah. Yeah. I don't want to change your behavior and go to hell. I want to change your heart and go to heaven. Yeah. So no more behavioral modification. We want translation from what? From the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. So we say, you are welcome as you are. Come in your sin. Come into the presence of God. Come into the mercy of God. Come into the grace of God. He will transform you. He will save you. He will clean you. Yeah. Our job is not to clean him. That's his job. Yeah. Our job is just to get him and point him towards him, who is the great cleaner. Yeah. We're the fishermen, but he's the one who guts them, who washes them, and fries them up, and gets them ready for heaven. We'll probably catch some of that later on in the afternoon with Pastor Brett, right? Titus 3:5 says this. He saved us not because of righteous things that we have done, but because of his mercy. He's coming back to his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit. Paul again tells us, or Peter tells us, 1 Peter 1:3 from the New Living Translation, it says this line. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is by his great mercy that we have been born again. Because God raised Jesus Christ from the dead, now we live with great expectation. There's an excitement in our heart that God is changing the people of the land. There's an excitement here. There should be an excitement that God wants to save your neighbor and your family and your colleagues. That God is after you. Not that one will be lost. He's after them all. People say to me, you're greedy. No, yeah, I am. I want them all. And I don't care whether we 500 or 50 or 5. It's not about that. But it's about getting as many people before the throne of God as possible. That's my job. The rest is up to him. The rest is his business. Because he said, I will build my church. But he tells me to go forth and to preach the gospel. To go forth and be his witness. To go forth and be his voice and be his hands and expression of his heart. That's our role. He does the hard work. We're supposed to enjoy and do the other part of the work. 1 Peter 2:9 says, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praise of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Isn't that what happened to me? I was translated out of darkness into his wonderful light. Verse 10 says, once you were not a people, but now you are a people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Now you have received mercy. Back to where it began. Hebrews 4:16. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. I'm sure everybody in this church, you've heard the gospel. You've responded to the gospel. And yet God's hand of mercy is still extended. Because we need his mercy with him. Salvation, I began the journey. 27 September 1991. I'm continuing that journey. And I don't know about you, but it's only I'm going to heaven. I'm going to be there. When my son, he's 27, he's in the ministry. But we sent him away to do a business degree. He said, keep away from all that. Go and get a job, blah, blah, blah. But the call of God was on his life. And you know the one thing we kept saying to him? No matter what you do, no matter who you marry, no matter what career you got, be there. Be there. That gentleman on his deathbed. What in the twinkling of an eye? John 3:16 is read. Why? Because I saw him. Be there. We've got to be there. And we've got to bring as many with us as possible. So what is our response? Romans 12:1 says this. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Let me read it from the message again. See, sometimes, when you know all the scripture, preacher is saying it, you're saying it in the back of your head, let me read it from a different angle, a different version. Romans 12:1, the message, so here again. So here's what I want you to do. God helping you. take your everyday, ordinary lives, your sleeping, eating, going to work, and walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. Embracing what God does for you is the very best thing that you can do for Him. Don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it, even without thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what He wants from you and quickly respond to you and respond to Him. Unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to His level of immaturity, God brings the best out of you, developing well-formed maturity in you. So what's He saying? When you're, whatever careers you are, whether it's in education, whether you're, you know, a housewife, whether you're working in a factory or driving a truck, don't just leave church and think, well, we get on with the rest of our lives until we hit Bible study midweek, or until we go to the ladies' meeting, or until we go whatever else. Don't get just so caught up in your culture that you forget about, why are we here? I am here to make a difference. I am here to be the hands and the representative, the ambassador of Christ Jesus. That's what we are. Your life makes a difference. You matter. You matter. In Ephesians, he talks about that He has created works before creation began. I've been looking at that recently, looking and just teasing it out and reading it out, and looking at different versions and looking at the context of it. So somehow in my mind's eye, this is what I see. Before creation began, God created a work for PJ. And it was in Newbridge, in Ireland. And I'm from a different place. I didn't even know I'd live in Ireland. But He has this work created for me. And then He came and He formed me and He gave me my DNA. He gave me my gifts. He gave me my everything I have. He gave me to match His plan. And on the 27th of September, 1991, when I stepped into the kingdom of God, I stepped into His perfect plan. God has a perfect plan and a perfect call on your life. But that perfection is not to give you a bigger car, right? It's not to get that you can eat ribeye steak. No, it's really nice in the States, I'll have to say.
Yeah.
That's not the purpose of this. Not that you even would be well. Not that He would even take away your sickness. That's not what this is about. But that you would walk out the gospel of Jesus Christ. That you would be His witness. That no matter what happens, you would tell your neighbor. You would tell your family. You would live it out in your calling and your going. That they would know what it is to be a follower of Christ Jesus. That they would know that we are real. They would know that it's by mercy. Not by religion. Not by order. Not by behavior. Was by the mercy of God, Jesus Christ, died on the cross. Let me finish with a final story. How did Ireland, a nation of saints and scholars, end up with 1% evangelical? Everyone celebrates St. Patrick's Day. Because from St. Patrick, men like Colin Kill and the great saints of old went all around Scotland, Wales, England, and into the darkest place of the world we knew at the time, which was Germany, into the deep forest. And they brought the gospel of Jesus Christ with them. How did this happen over such a short period of time that now we have less than 1% who are born again evangelical? And I believe this story tells the story of the church. It's called The Life-Saving Station. It was written back in 1953. It says, on a dangerous seacoast where shipwrecks often occur, was once a crude little life-saving station. The building was just a hut. There was only one boat. But a few devoted members kept a constant watch over the sea and with no thought for their own comfort went out day and night tirelessly searching for the lost. Some of those who were saved and various others in the surrounding area wanted to become associated with the station and gave up their time, money and effort for the support of this work. New boats were bought and new crews were trained. The little life-saving station grew. Some of the members of the life-saving station were unhappy that the building was so crude and poorly equipped. They felt that a more comfortable place should be provided at the first refuge of those saved from the sea. They replaced the emergency cots with beds and put better furniture in the enlarged building. Now the life-saving station became a popular gathering place for its members, and they decorated it beautifully because they were used to it and they got a sort of. Fewer members were now interested in going to sea on a life-saving mission, So the hard lifeboat crews to do this work. The life-saving motif still prevailed in the club's decorations, and there was a liturgical lifeboat in the room where the club's initiations were held. About this time, a large ship wrecked off the coast, and the hard crews brought in boatloads of cold, wet, half-drowned people. They were dirty and sick. The beautiful new club was in chaos, so the property committee immediately had a shower block built outside where victims of shipwrecks could be cleared up without coming inside. At the next meeting, there was a split among the club membership. Most of the members wanted to stop the club's life-saving activities for being unpleasant and a hindrance to the normal social life of the club. Some members insisted upon life-saving as their primary purpose and pointed out that they were still called a life-saving station. But they were finally voted down and told that if they wanted to save the lives of all the various kinds of people who were shipwrecked in these waters, they could begin with their own life-saving station. So they did. As years went by, the new station experienced the same changes that had occurred in the old. It evolved into a club, and yet another life-saving station was founded. History continues to repeat itself, and if you visit that sea coast today, you will find a number of exclusive clubs along the shore. Shipwrecks are frequent in these waters, but most of the people drown. May it never be said about us that most of the people drown. We have been made. There's a song called History Makers from years ago, probably 20 years ago. It was a group, an English group. We used to think that's a little bit over the top. But the day I came to know Jesus, my history was changed forever. When I have the privilege of pointing somebody to Christ, their history is changed forever. Guys, we have been called to be history makers. And I'm the guy with the funny accent. I'm the guy who lives 5,000 miles away. But it doesn't matter. Right across this globe, north, south, east, and west, God has called us to be his witnesses and to share grace, to share his mercy, to share his love, and to make a difference in the world that we live in. So let's just pray and we'll finish it. Father, I want to thank you for your mercy. Your mercy. And Lord, a great thing I've learned, Lord, is that your mercy is new every morning. Lord, I got up this morning and I can start again. Lord, here we are in church right now. We can start again. We're in this building. We leave this place and the church is leaving. Leave behind just an empty building. Father, I pray, Lord, for us who have received mercy, would you allow us to expand and extend that mercy to others? Even now, Lord, would you remind us of your goodness and your kindness towards us? Would you remind us, Lord, of that foundation that we have in you, Christ Jesus? Remind us, Lord, of the hope for which you have, Lord, that no matter what happens, whether I'm run down by a truck or whatever happens, Lord, I'm going to be in your presence in an instant. Remind us, Lord, of your love and your grace towards us, your extended hand. And Father, would you, Lord, just empower us, Lord, to open our mouth in every occasion. Would you remind us, Lord, that no matter where we are, whether we're in church or in the truck or on the street or in the shopping mall, that we are your ambassadors. We are your witnesses. And that we live in a world that are thirsty and hungry and dying for what we have. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, brothers.
Thank you.
And restores my soul, satisfies my need.
Thank you for listening to Staying the Course with Pastor Brett Peterson. If you would like a copy of this message or would like to submit a prayer request or comment, contact us at 949-888-5777 or email us at info@ccbcu.edu. God bless you as you seek and serve him. Remember, stay the course, and we'll see you next week.
I love your word. I love the way it comes. satisfies my need.